Good morning, everyone. Worshipping at home? Is it? We miss you. We wish you were here. And it's our prayer that you worship with us at home and you lift up the name of Jesus along with David and I and with all Parks AAG who are at home worshipping with us. Please feel free to sing along. Actually, we would prefer you to sing along with us. And as we pray, I'll just pray this morning. Father God, we thank you that you are on the throne. Lord Jesus, that above all else, you rule and you reign. And we declare the name of Jesus above every other name, the name that at every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that you, Lord Jesus, are Lord. Hallelujah. And what can we do but sing? And we, Lord Jesus, we give this time over to you. We give this time to you to wait upon you, to glorify your name, to magnify your name. Lord Jesus, be with us as we adjust to these new circumstances. Lord, nothing is a surprise to you. Nothing is a surprise. I pray that you'll comfort your people as we look to you this morning. We thank you, Lord, that you're a shield about us and that you are the lifter of our heads. And we ask that you bless this time together in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. I thought I'd start with a faster song today. Even though we're all at home, we don't have a drummer, it's all good. Okay. You might want to get up out of your seat for this one.
Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, your love makes me sing. Your love is surprising, I can feel it rising. All the joy that's growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. And I can feel this God song rising up in me. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, 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 your love makes me sing.
Yes, you make me sing.
Lord, you make me sing, sing, sing. Yes, you make me sing. Hallelujah.
From the top.
Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me. Hallelujah, oh hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, your love makes me sing. Your love is surprising, I can feel it rising. All the joy that's growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this God song rising up in me. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, 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 your love makes me sing. Yes, you make me sing. Lord, you make me sing, sing, sing. How you make me free.
Bless the Lord. The victor's crown. There's truth in this. There's truth in this. That He is always fighting for us. He is always praying for us. Let's turn our eyes to these truths that He is, that He wears the victor's crown.
You were always fighting for us, heaven's angels all around. My delight is found in knowing that you wear the victor's crown. You're my help and my defender, you're my savior and my friend. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you. The mention of your greatness, in your name I will bow down. In your presence fear is silent, for you wear the victor's crown. You're my glory, fill this temple, let your power overflow. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you. Hallelujah. You have overcome. You have overcome. Hallelujah. Jesus, you have overcome the world. As the lost become the found, you can never be defeated, for you wear the victor's crown. You are Jesus the Messiah, you're the hope of all the world. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you. Hallelujah.
Of Jesus over this land. Hallelujah. Yes, Jesus.
Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome, you overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome, you overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome, you overcome. At the cross the work was finished. You were buried in the ground.
But the grave could not contain you, for you wear the victor's crown.
The victor's crown.
We sing hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Risen King.
Hallelujah. You have overcome. You have overcome. Hallelujah. Jesus, you have overcome the world. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome.
Yes, Lord, you have overcome.
Amen.
You have overcome the world. Take heart, for I've overcome the world. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Through you we are overcomers. Through you we are more than overcomers through him who set us free. You've set us free. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. This is our God. And we fall at your feet this morning.
Your grace is enough, more than I need. At your word I will believe. I wait for you, draw near again. Let your spirit make me new, and I will fall at your feet. I will fall at your feet, and I will worship you here. Your presence in me, Jesus, light the way. By the power of your word, I am restored, I am redeemed. By your spirit I am free, and I will fall at your feet. I will fall at your feet, and I will worship you here. Freely you gave it all for us, surrendered your life upon that cross. Great is the love poured out for all. This is our God. Lifted on high from death to life, forever our God is glorified. Servant and King, rescued the world, this is our God. And I will fall at your feet, I will fall at your feet.
lifted on high from death to life. Forever our God is glorified. Servant and King, rescued the world. This is our God.
As we fall at your feet and we worship you, this is our God. We worship you for who you are, for what you have done, and what you will continue to do. Worship you, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
You are holy. There is none like you. Who can stand before you? Oh, we thank you for the gift of eternal life, that we can stand before you because of the blood of Jesus. There is none like you. Let's worship our Lord. Glory to you alone.
You are holy. None like you. You are holy, holy. Glory to you alone.
You are holy.
You are holy, holy. Lord, there is none.
Your praises.
I'll sing your praises forever, deeper in love with you. Here in your courts where I'm close to your throne, I've found where praises forever, deeper in love with you. Here in your courts where I'm close to your throne, I found where I belong. I'll sing your praises forever, deeper in love with you. Here in your courts where I'm close to your throne, I found where I belong. Here in your courts where I'm close to your throne, I found where I found where I belong.
Hallelujah. Bless your name, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Worship you. Thank you, Lord.
Welcome to worship. We're so glad you could join us. I believe that this current lockdown, I'm on okay, you can hear me okay. I believe that this current lockdown is a gift from God to give us impetus to pursue personal revival. We dug in last week into 1 Corinthians 10, how the rock always journeys with us. And Jesus Christ, the rock, cries out to us, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink." And so the Lord says, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never hunger. He who believes in me shall never thirst." So he is calling us right now to enter into the living water, to keep drinking and drinking and drinking until you are in the depths of the river of God. Be revived in the Lord Jesus Christ. Enter into revival. The season of springtime is upon us, but the spiritual springtime starts now. Press in, first the spiritual, then the natural. Press into revival. Draw near to him and he will draw near to you. Major aspect of revival is a return to the Word of God, the Bible. And it says in Deuteronomy chapter 8, God took you into the wilderness to humble you and to test your heart. He caused you to experience hunger in order that you might know that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And so God is stirring his church worldwide to return to the Word of God, to dust off the Bible and get back into God's Word. Indeed, if we do not know God's Word personally, then we will be led astray in the season that lies ahead. I urge you and encourage you, does your daily devotional take you through a Bible reading plan that takes you through the whole Bible? If not, then revive your commitment to read the whole, every word of God, every word. Hallelujah. Paul has been addressing questions asked of him by the church in Corinth and finished chapter 10 by saying more about eating meat in a loving, sensitive, caring way, and finishes with this classic verse, 1 Corinthians 10:31. "Therefore, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all for the glory of God." Paul now focuses in the next four chapters on honoring God in public worship, including the wearing of head coverings, the proper way to partake in the Lord's Supper, and the proper moving in the gifts of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 1. "Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. I praise you for remembering me in everything and for holding to the traditions just as I pass them on to you. But I want you to realize that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of the woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. Every man who prays or prophesies with his head covered dishonors his head. But every woman who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered dishonors her head. It is the same as having her head shaved. For if a woman does not cover her head, she might as well have her hair cut off. But if it is a disgrace for a woman to have her hair cut off or her head shaved, then she should cover her head. A man ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and glory of God, but woman is the glory of man. For man did not come from woman, but woman from man. Neither was man created for woman, but woman for man. It is for this reason that a woman ought to have authority over her own head, because of the angels. Nevertheless, in the Lord, woman is not independent of man, nor is man independent of woman. For as woman came from man, so also man is born of woman. But everything comes from God. Judge for yourselves. Is it proper for a woman to pray to God with a head uncovered? Does not the very nature of things teach you that if a man has long hair, it is a disgrace to him? but that if a woman has long hair, it is her glory. For long hair is given to her as a covering. If anyone wants to be contentious about this, we have no other practice, nor do the churches of God. The Lord open, the Lord's touch the rock and bring forth living waters from this passage of Scripture. Honor God in public worship. The form of the Christian worship service must express the nature of Christ. And the behavior of worshipers must exemplify his character and his humility, his loving servant heart. The way people dress and the relationship between husbands and wives can impact Christian worship services. This passage is an interesting mix of God's created order and of local customs. Verse 3, I want you to realize that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. God created marriage. He created husbands and wives to be a wonderful reflection of the glorious relationship between the Father and the Son, Jesus Christ. For between the Father and the Son, there is perfect harmony and unity, a continuous flow of steadfast, unfailing love. Equality, but each with differing roles to accomplish differing functions. A mutual flowing in with each other's great authority, where the Son flows in, submits to the authority of the Father, but this by no means indicate that the Son is any way inferior to the Father. They are equal. It is a flowing of relationship and of oneness. The Son exalts the Father, and the Father exalts the Son. As I read just some of the scriptures that reveal this glory, the Lord grant to you a double vision of the glory of the relationship between the Father and the Son, and also the glory of the relationship between husband and wife. Beginning in John 4:34, my food, said Jesus, is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. John 5:19, Jesus gave them this answer, very truly I tell you, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can only do what he sees his Father doing, because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all. By myself I can do nothing. I judge only as I hear, and my judgment is just. For I seek not to please myself, but him who sent me. John 8:28, Jesus said, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing of my own, but speak just what the Father has taught me. For we, male and female, are created in Christ's image. We are joint heirs with Christ. Caesar Augustus, who had statues of himself erected around the Roman Empire with his toga covering his head, thus claiming authority over the cultic worship. Pagan priests covered their head with their toga while serving in worship. The worship of Jesus required men to lift up holy hands with their head uncovered. In the culture of the day, the wearing of head covering by women indicated exclusive devotion to their husband or modesty and reservation for their future husband. There was a growing trend during that time of women having their head uncovered to indicate that they have loose morals and they live an immoral life. I'm available. This was a disgraceful way of dressing in the Christian community and therefore was forbidden. Even in our casual, laid-back Aussie culture, there are still disgraceful ways of dressing. Women of the night, that is prostitutes, have a certain way of dressing in order to attract customers. While we desire to help prostitutes get free from that terrible lifestyle, we deplore the disgraceful ways of dressing, and there has been occasions where people have been sent home from a church meeting to get dressed in an appropriate way. If we were having normal church today with everyone here, I probably would have turned up in my tracksuit and joggers to try and make a point. And I would have, at this point in my message, said, well, how did you respond with seeing me dressed in my tracksuit and joggers? Did it affect your worship? Did it distract you from hearing the Word of God? How did it impact you? For many people, it wouldn't have mattered at all. In fact, I was dressed exactly that way just over a week ago when I brought the Word of God to our youth group after we saw Chariots of Fire. But there's appropriate ways of dressing, and those who do the principles of preaching will be taught about appropriate dress and also made to watch themselves preaching to see whether they have any distracting mannerisms that detract from the Word of God. You see, we are to do everything to honour and cause the Word of God to be heard and to applied, and not to do anything within ourselves to detract from that. There are many controversies in this passage, and we are beset by an amazing array of controversies in this season, if you pay attention to social media or even the news. For example, the humble face mask is a controversy. You may think that it's more healthy to not wear a face mask than to wear a face mask, and if you think that, you've probably got a whole series of links to medical experts who say exactly that. Well, because we have the luxury of living in a democratic society, and we pray that that will continue until the Lord returns, and we're going to pray about that too, you have the luxury of protesting, lodging your protest with the powers that be. And you would indicate, you probably even put links in to where certain medical authorities say it's safer to not wear a face mask than to wear a face mask. In fact, something similar like that happened Thursday the 24th of June. A senior health official communicated by a Zoom meeting to representatives of all the denominations new restrictions, including that those singing in church, even while doing live streaming, must have a face mask on. This was dutifully communicated to all the local church leaders on Friday morning. But when Martin Isles of Australian Christian Lobby, and God bless Martin Isles, if you don't subscribe to his emails, get them. And Martin Isles, when he heard of it, he felt it was unreasonable and unjust compared to the restrictions on singers in the live performance industry. So Martin urged everyone to lodge their appeal. This resulted in thousands and thousands of emails to those in authority. And by the next day, midday, Brad Hazzard issued an update of the restrictions saying that while you are doing your live streaming, two singers are allowed to remove their face mask, but there must only be two other people in the room, the technicians, no one else. Then when they're finished singing, as you saw, we put our face mask back on. in case you were wondering, I was out in the foyer while the worship was happening to abide by that rule. We see that we can appeal. We see that things can change through our appeal, but it would have been and it will be entirely inappropriate, foolish, unloving, uncaring, unchristlike, a terrible witness to go to a protest in Sydney during a pandemic not wearing your face masks. Many believe that the protest 2 weeks ago has contributed significantly to the spike in numbers of COVID cases over the last few days. We were delighted that we could still do scripture in schools in regions outside of Greater Sydney, but there was a page full of restrictions that we needed to pay diligent attention to as we went into the school. Face masks must be worn in entering the school and also entering the classroom, but they said initially face masks may be removed when you speak to the class. Then it got more confusing because they kept adjusting the rules day by day, including saying, well, it's up to the local school, check with your principal, check with your classroom teacher. So I went off to scripture, thanking God in my heart, putting the face mask on, but going first of all with a mandate, an authority to boldly teach and proclaim God's word. But I also went with humility by wearing my face mask and being very respectful to all in authority in the school. And I would dutifully ask each teacher, is it okay that I remove my face mask while I speak to the class? And there was one dear teacher who grabbed her face mask. She said, yeah, I'm happy to put my face mask on if you want me to. I said, no, I'm just checking. Can I take my face mask off while I'm talking to the class? Oh, go for it, she says. That's fine, totally fine. There was one teacher when I went into the classroom and she had a face mask on and I did not even ask her if she was okay if I took my face mask on. I just, out of respect for her, kept my face mask on and addressed the class, and I knew that God was doing something special, not only in the teacher, but in the whole class by my act of humility. We need to find right ways of showing respect. 1 Corinthians 11:10, it is for this reason that a woman ought to have authority over her own head, because of the angels. Angels are involved in every gathering in Jesus' name. Hebrews 1:13 says, to which of the angels did God ever say, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies a footstool for your feet? Are not angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who inherit salvation? Not flowing in divine order, not flowing in humility or honor or servanthood, not examining our hearts as we come to worship, hinders the flow of angels' blessings and their ministry to us as we worship. And it also obscures the flow of wisdom from us to them. For angels come to gain more wisdom from the church, as it says in Ephesians 3:9, my passion is to enlighten every person to this divine mystery in Christ. It was hidden for ages past until now and kept a secret in the heart of God, the creator of all. The purpose of this was to unveil before every throne, every rank of angelic orders in the heavenly realm, to every angel, God's full and diverse wisdom revealed through the church. And so angels come not only to bless us as we flow in divine order, but also to receive divine wisdom as the church proclaims the gospel, as the church worships in a way that is honouring to God. We, his church, are messengers to angels in how we proclaim the gospel and how we honour Christ. 1 Corinthians 11:14. Does not the very nature of things teach you that if a man has long hair like a woman, it is a disgrace to him? But that if a woman has long hair, it is her glory. For long hair is given to her as a covering. If anyone wants to be contentious about this, we have no other practice, nor do the churches of God. When I was a teenager, it was fashionable for guys, including most male teachers, to have long hair. But it wasn't like the hair of a woman. You look at the photos, radically different to the way women wear their hair, except we had one guy who wore his hair in an effeminate way. And at our recent high school reunion, my friend was very masculine in his appearance. Very masculine. I don't know where you, have you ever seen an episode of Arne's Brush with Fame? If you were here, I'd give me a wave. And there was a very engaging episode just recently where Arne has Missy Higgins to paint her portrait, and his incredible gift of drawing people out to share their heart. And the most immediate evident thing when you saw Missy was you recognised her face, but everything about her, everything else was very different. Not only was her appearance very different, her whole demeanour was very different. And as she opened up, she was obviously glowing in contentment. And as she opened up, she says, "Well, I fell in love with a man, and we have a wonderful marriage and two wonderful children, and I'm loving being a mother." And she did touch on what it was like, because she gained fame as a young teenager, worldwide fame as a singer-songwriter, and she said, "The media constantly put pressure on me to come out." And that was as much as she was going to say. Glowing in contentment. We're not here to argue about differences of opinion. We're not here to display arrogance and disunity in the way we dress or behave during worship. Disciples of Christ are commanded to avoid senseless controversies and rather display humility, honour, submission, respect, love, unity in Christ and his servant's heart. The Father, the Son, and the Spirit are equal in their nature, equal in their authority. And they are one, flowing together in perfect harmony, yet differing in roles, accomplishing different functions. In incredible love, the Father offered up his only Son. In amazing love, Jesus offered himself up for us all. In koinonia love, koinonia, sweet communion, fellowship, binding together, the Spirit reveals the glory of the Son and the saving work of the cross. We submit to his saving work. We reach out and receive what Jesus has done for us. We receive his love and we allow him to transform us as we come to the cross. Let's pray. Search us, Lord, and see if there's any arrogant way in us of self-will, of independence, of boasting in ourselves. Grant each of us true humility. Teach us all the appropriate way to dress and how to have our heart honouring you when we gather to worship. Lord, we pray that you would grant that every married couple would be a wonderful reflection of the glory of the relationship between the Father and the Son. Bless, so bless every marriage. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that we can come to you and drink. And we drink right now. Bring your refreshing, Lord. We drink in you. Lord, cause us to keep drinking you in and drinking you in until we're floating in the rivers of living water. You are our delight. You are the bread of life. We feed on you now, Lord God. We feed on you, Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the promise of personal revival. And we ask, Lord, you would begin even right now as we share together the emblems of your death and resurrection. Bring a flow into personal revival. Restore our passion for God's word, the Bible, that we would feed on every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. We ask that you would cleanse us from every sin, everything that dishonors you, in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus offered himself up willingly out of love, his amazing love for you and me. He said, "This bread is my body. Take, eat. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's eat together. "This is the cup of the covenant in my blood, says the Lord Jesus, for the remission of sins." Let's drink together. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We yearn for revival. Spirit of God, move. Breathe life now. Spirit of God, breathe life. Thank you that the cross is a place of revival. Thank you that the blood of Jesus brings revival. Thank you that the word of God is given to us in the time of revival. We re-embrace your word, Lord God. We re-embrace you. Lead us into this spiritual springtime. Thank you, Lord, for your presence with us. For he's not far from any one of you. For in him we live and we move and we have our being. So be revived, be revived, be refreshed. Lord, we just pray for your assistance for our leaders, Lord, in this distressing time. We pray especially for protection over Aboriginal communities. We pray for a flow of vaccines there. We pray that you would accelerate the vaccination process. We pray for a spirit of cooperation in the Australian people. We pray that you would give understanding, that each person would discern the time we are living in and live in wisdom rather than foolishness. We bring to you our needs and we thank you, Lord, that you provide for every need. We pray for healing. We thank you for the improvement in health in many over the last week. Pray that you would make the way for Bill to return home. Continue to be with Sharon and Sharon Lister. Give her comfort at loss of her partner. We thank you, Lord, that we always have opportunities to sow and to give freely. We pray that you would take our giving and use it to increase your kingdom. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thank you for the angels that are imparting blessings right now. Thank you, Lord, that we too, likewise, as we proclaim the gospel, bring blessings to them. We worship you. We praise you. We magnify you, for you are holy and you are worthy of all glory. Grant that whatever we do, whatever we say, however we dress, wherever we go, that we would give all glory to you. Amen. Thank you for being with us today. We'll find out later on the week what will be happening with the lifting of restrictions, and I'll communicate by email. The Lord thoroughly bless and refresh you every day as you feed on him, as you wait in his presence, as you drink from the rivers of living water. God grant that you experience his reviving power every day in the weeks and months that lie ahead. God bless you. Thank you so much, Musos.
I bow my knee where your blood was shed for me. There's no greater love than this. You have overcome the grave. Your glory fills the highest place. What can separate me now? At the cross I bow my knee where your blood was shed for me. There's no greater love than this. You have overcome the grave. Your glory fills the highest place. What can separate me now? You tore the veil. You made a way when you said that it is done. You tore the veil. You made a way when you said that it is done. And when the earth fades, falls from my you stand before me, I know you love me, I know you love me.
Yes, Jesus, thank you, Lord, that you love us, and we do bow our knee before you, our Lord. Your blood that was shed for us. There was no greater love than that. And we hold that in our hearts as we go from this place. We pray your richest blessings over your people this week, especially today. Lord, be with us as we look to you. In Jesus' name, amen. See everybody.